which is a good thing. So good things also should be communicated. Recently, there was another, I think the Times of India had a digital article I read about how, you know, smart bikes, super bikes, right, BMW bikes, etc., are some of the gifts that the companies are giving, the IT companies are giving. So things are looking up. And of course, we have the numbers of opportunities. And the beauty of this entire workforce industry or the employment industry is that they are not very clear what to expect out of the employees. If I were to go for a job, they would have 110 expectations given that I have so much of experience. And I may or may not match. And then they would know what to do with it, what to, you know, whether to train me or do like that. Not just because of my age, but it's about with just about everybody. But the beauty or the good thing about the you know, freshers just out of college, the advantage that you have is that no problem. Whatever he has done, we can always train and do that, and we can always train him. So the people are giving more thrust on freshers. So it's a good thing that, you know, you people are where you are at this particular point of time. I remember when we graduated from my college. I will not reveal the date because then you will try to guess my age. Okay, so when I graduated, in my class of 100 in mechanical engineering, I'm a mechanical, 3 people got campus placement. Okay, that is all. Campus placement that happened, and other people, about 15-20 people, you know, went abroad for further studies, and the rest of us, including me, went to the employment exchange in Chennai. Now, I'm from Tamil Nadu myself, so went to the employment exchange in Chennai and got our name registered, hoping that someday we'll get a call. Of course, then we went into the private sector and all that. That's a different case. So what we are doing right now, let's now move to data science. Okay. So data science, like our chairman has already you know, appraised, huge amounts of data just about everywhere, and every decision is based on data. Okay. Whether it is a simple thing like online shopping, or is it like, you know, we're talking about the huge stock markets, which is booming. Anybody is following? You're talking about the Internet of Things. Everything is connected in the cyber-physical world where data is being generated. All right. Or if it is the Mars rover. All right. Even that is sending, and it's very expensive, no? The data, the receipt, the transmission, the flow of data of the Mars rover coming and going for back, it's a very expensive affair. That is probably the most expensive data transfer that we have. But we are having there also we are having the enormous amount of data that is there. And of course, we can already know about, nothing to speak about, Google, Facebook, LinkedIn, YouTube, etc. I mean, things are moving, and now we are ourselves creating data. I'm sure many of you wear smart watches and smart devices. The data you are transmitting. So what is happening to this? Now, data generation is one thing. Mars rover is sending data. Your Fitbit is sending data. Whenever you make purchases on Amazon or Flipkart or any of those e-commerce portals, you are getting your product, but the data that you purchased, Nitin Mishra purchased this, last month and he purchased this. What is the use? What is that I can extract from that? What is that oil that I can pull out of it? Is what everybody is looking at. Because data generation is very easy. You just need to put a small IoT sensor and data generation starts. All right, now I'll give you a quick scenario. We also do a lot of consulting, and some of you may be aware of the e-rickshaws. E-rickshaws have become very popular in northern parts of India, Delhi, Kanpur, Lucknow, etc. Those areas, these e-rickshaws have become very popular. So these e-rickshaws, prior to the pandemic, used to come from China in the completely knockdown condition. The frames used to be manufactured by the people here, and which is a good thing because it generated huge amount of employment. The engine block, the transmission, everything was put into place, and then they used to put it, and of course the battery used to come separately. Now there is a company in India who is now manufacturing e-rickshaw batteries, and they are putting a small 2G chip in that particular battery. If you want, you can activate that 2G chip to your mobile service provider to collect the data. If you don't want, fine. Okay, this is what it works. So now when you if you activate that, what is going to happen is it is going to send this continuously, alright, to the server, to the cloud server. It is going to continuously send the data, and it is going to tell you at what rate the charge in the battery is going on, at what rate it is increasing. When it is totally idle, what time to what time it was idle, that is the vehicle was not in motion. What time the charge was rapidly declining, meaning the vehicle must have been going uphill. So we have made all these things. Now the battery company approached us. They said, we have 4 months of data and their cloud storage is exploding and they are thinking of simply deleting because they have absolutely no idea what to do with the data. All right. So you are a data science organization. You are consulting also. Can you tell me what can be done with this? Now imagine what we are in the future, right? You left, right and center, we are creating data, but not everybody is aware what to do with it. So of course, we worked out a proof of concept and told them what all the things we can do, how analysis, how battery maintenance and all those things we could do. And that process is then of course the pandemic, so a lot of holds there. So this is what we need to talk. And just to give you a little more context of the size of data, I think most of you may be aware, most of you are partaking in all this. You are also responsible for the increase in the amount of data. Some of you may be uploading YouTube videos. Some of you may be observing, just observing content. Some of you may be tweeting. And all these things. All right. So this is, etc. what we have. Okay. Now, given that this amount, much amount of data is already generated, what do we do with it? Okay. Let us now break it down and look into the various aspects, the various slices that we can pull out from this. So we have something called as artificial intelligence. We have data science, we have data mining, we have machine learning, we have deep learning. So let us take it one by one. So artificial intelligence is just about everything which we expect of a human being. The intelligence that is of a human being, we expect that to be available. All right. Sorry. Yeah. The intelligence of the human being that we expect. All right. Yeah. I was just waiting for this. In the artificial sector. So anything and everything that we do, which can save time for us, is artificial intelligence. Now that seems a little disappointing, given that everybody expected the artificial intelligence to be something really very sexy and something really great. But artificial intelligence is very simple. All right. Your intelligent activities that a human being does when you automate it, it is artificial intelligence. Now, how do we do that? We do it with an enormous amount of data, and for that we require what is called as data science. So once again, split the words data and science separately. So science, immediately I think physics, chemistry, biology comes to your mind. So what all you do, you slice and dice the data, you mix the data and create a new kind of data, chemistry, you slice and dice, biology, you subject the data to some kind of, you know, some kind of force, some kind of effects, and see what is the result of because of that. So that is your, you know, physics. So whatever you can do on data, the scientific experiments that you do on the data with the intention of knowing more about it is simply data science. As simple as that. Very, very high level, very simple explanation, nothing, no rocket science. Then what is data mining? Okay. Now again, split the word into two, data and mining. So what is mining? You mine for, what do you mine for? Various places of our country you mine for carbon, coal, all right? You mine for copper, you mine for silver, you mine for gold, you mine again for diamonds. Am I communicating? Sorry, I don't have the chat window open, so I'm not able to see the messages, but I'm assuming, yeah, okay, we can have the Q&As later on. So we mine for this, so we mine for something precious. Similarly, I have data, all right? So I have data, I mine on that data for something precious, something valuable. Now, what is value? Very simple. Value is money. I think let us give it an Indian context. Value is money. Value is time. So if anything, any activity that can be done with the help of data, that can save time, that can save money, that can increase profits, that is the value proposition. Okay? So the data mining is something we do with an intention of creating profit. The profit can be monetary profit or time profit. These are only two things that we are concerned about, right? Time and money. There is nothing else which is profitable today. Let us not talk about the intangibles of happiness, health and that is also there, but the tangible part of it is the issue. So that is called as data mining. Now, what is machine learning? Let me explain machine learning, then I'll probably get it. So what is machine learning? Once again, the machine learning is all the steps, all the you put it this way, all the steps, all the SOPs, standard operating procedures, all right, a flow diagram, all these things that help you achieve the profit motive, the data mining. So the specific algorithm, data mining is the theory for which I want to make the profit. Machine learning is the machine or the actual thing that is going to create that particular profit. So data mining is the bigger set and machine learning is the subset within that. Right? So that is machine learning, which will actually translate the idea what data mining has into actual actionable outcomes, which is money, time, increase in money, saving of time, etc. So this is essentially what we have. Then we have what is called as deep learning. This is where the people, you know, use the word deep learning. Deep learning is essentially what artificial intelligence is all about. All right. So when you talk about deep learning, machine learning, let us say when you talk about machine learning, you have these. When you talk about machine learning, let us say I have these steps. All right. Step 1, do this. Step 2, do this. Step 3, do this. Step 4, do this. Step 5, do this. Result, profit. When you follow these steps, keep following these steps, the machine learning algorithm will keep giving you profit. The deep learning algorithm questions this. Why not I do this? Will I get profits? Why not I do this? Will I get profits? It continually updates and changes the value proposition. See, you have explained that you want profits. So profits is something you want. These are the steps that you want me to do. Let me do now. Let me try to do what I have to do. Let me try to understand what can I do. Can I do something more, something less? Can I change some parameters? Can I change something here? Can I do this? Can I keep increasing? Now, right now, if I do these steps, I'm getting 100 rupees per day. Can I make that 100 to 101? I make some changes, it becomes 98. Oh, maybe I made a mistake. So what I should do, I'll change it back to 100. Then what should I do to make it 101? So it is a process by which it continually learns and tries to improve upon the profit proposition. Okay, so that is essentially the four layers of the this is called the onion peel diagram, where we have the artificial intelligence, data science, data mining, machine learning, and deep learning. Within deep learning, you have recurrent neural networks, convolutional neural networks, all those things. I'm assuming some of it you might have already learned, but yeah, nevertheless. So this is some of the things that are there. And like our chairman has already mentioned, right, we are looking at amazing booms with reference to data science specifically, and people are moving into that particular space. So this particular article is very interesting. This is again for experienced people. Maybe you people may not relate, but if you are entering into the data science career, you can imagine the kind of, this is probably 10 years down the line. So there was a HR consulting firm who had managed to hire some 8 people, 6 people for position, data science position, all of them 10, 12 years of experience. And ultimately what happened was they all quit within 6 months, and the company was having a very bad feedback, and the fellow was under a lot of pressure from the company because, you know, they obviously expect people to work for them for a long. So within 6 months, all of them quit. Now, these are employments in the US where most of them are contractual, where the contracts are very, very stringent and ironclad contracts, which ensures that, ensure that if you want to quit halfway through your contract, let us say a 2 year contract, you may have to end up paying probably the entire 2 year wages, not just, you know, do your 3 months. They have legal clauses placed in them. So these people were willing to break the contract, pay the fees much extra, because the next job was probably giving them even more. So that is essentially the great thing that is happening. So if you are, I'm just foreseeing that 10 years, if you are a data scientist for 10 years, all right, 10 years down the line, you can be like this. I'm not advising you people to do that, but this is something that is possible. So what does data science consist of? I'll quickly do this, and then probably I'll take one small chapter just to explain to you how the learning process, things that you already know, I'll be explaining again. So statistical analysis, inferential statistics, sampling techniques, descriptive analysis, central limit theorem, confidence interval. See, some of the fundamentals of statistics will be explained. Then we have data mining, supervised and unsupervised. There are two things, all right, that are there. All right. So we have the supervised and unsupervised learning. So we have correlation analysis, regression analysis, classification, all these things we have. So we'll be learning, we'll be learning about these aspects as part of the, you know, supervised learning. And then as part of the unsupervised learning, there are various other things. I'll just get into the details of that. Then working with unstructured data, once again, an introductory message, the unstructured data, structured and unstructured data is something that was mentioned. So very simply, structured data is which can be put into a tabular format, rows and columns, and which is not in the tabular format is unstructured data. So we have various things that we do with that. So textual data, the very speech that I'm giving, which is currently being recorded. All right, so ideally what should happen is at the end of this entire session, all right, in future, maybe in about 6 months time, at the end of it, we will have smart applications embedded into our Google Meets, GoTo Meetings, etc., which will probably immediately create if you subscribe for that service, it will immediately give you a gist of the topics, gist of things that have been done. Within probably 10 minutes, it will do a processing. We'll go through the entire recording, understand the word, and probably give you the entire presentation or whatever is there as a PPT with a new presentation. That in this particular slide, the trainer talked about these five aspects. In this particular slide, the trainer was, now for instance, on this slide, whatever I've spoken about, what is artificial data science, data mining, text mining, machine learning and deep learning, the textual aspects of it, will be available. That is the future that we are looking at. So text, studying about the textual data and trying to extract the insights from the textual data is another thing. And then of course, forecasting is working with time series data. So this is a small, I would say probably about 80%, 70 to 80% of what data science is all about, all right? Generally it contains, so it has statistics, it has machine learning, it has unstructured, working with unstructured data, it has working with time series. It also has one, what is called as BI2, one or two BI2s, so Power BI, Tableau, Click, all these things are something that are very famous. So these are some of the fundamentals that are there. Now, interestingly, Microsoft Excel is slowly and steadily improving, and its complete version is now having a lot of ML, ML capabilities in them. But of course, there is a limitation. There is only so much that you can load into an Excel file. You need to have large data, big data, SQL servers, etc. So that's a little bit of a problem. So that's essentially it. This is just basically about us and the kind of places that we, you know, place our people and corporate trainings, etc. This is our team. And anyway, this, I'll just quickly skip through this. Yeah. So that is basically some of the things that I thought I'll just share. And then let me just quickly, you know, also discuss about another topic that is very close to me. Okay. So before we continue, let me just quickly see if there are any no messages. All right. So I just want to show you a quick case study, which is an interesting case study on the connection of the live analytics that we have, okay, which is pretty interesting. It is so there is this woman who goes for jogging every day, and when she goes for jogging, she wears a wearable device which tells her performance. So she goes for jogging, and when she finishes the jogging that day, she is surprised to know that today her performance has been a little poor. She generally is able to run this distance of 2.73 kilometers in 14.16 minutes. Today she has taken 15.24 minutes. So obviously, if you are a competitive person, you'll be wondering what happened, and let me try again. What is wrong? What happened? Like that, you're thinking. So anyway, she boards a cab, which is Uber or Ola or whatever. She boards the cab, puts on her Google Glass, all right, or uses her mobile phone, whatever, and says, okay, probably my running shoe grip or whatever may be not good. So when is the right time that one should replace the running shoes? Okay, because maybe the shoes have worn out. When or after how many miles or whatever is the question she does, and she clicks on this button. Now, as soon as she clicks on this button, the entire internet goes on the internet a persona, and I'm going to treat it as a person and try to explain the scenario here. So the internet comes to know that there is this person who is looking to replace running shoes. So that fellow is very excited. Alright, so that person wants to find out what it is, and they try to find out, okay, this particular search for the replaced running shoes came from a device in which another application was running, which was the Uber, because your Uber trip is being recorded in that. So great, so can you now tell me who is that, which Uber this particular person is? This person is in a Uber Premier car, which has an in-car entertainment, in-car screen where you can probably watch something. So they pause the content on the car and they push in their advertisement. New Balance shoes, they push in their advertisement. Now imagine, a person who is looking at his mobile phone suddenly looks up. That is the reaction one person will have. What is this? I'm looking in my phone, external device, an external device is able to tell me that you need to so that is something that is going to be a little weird for them. Okay, now we cannot be sure that the person would have seen it. I'm looking at my mobile, I'm looking at my mobile. Whatever is going in the front, I don't know, like we do in class. Yes or no? All right. When we were having regular classes, you used to be looking down in your tables. No, are you listening? Yes, ma'am. Right? I've been there, done that, so don't deny it. Anyway, so what if a person has missed? Now we know that this particular car is traveling on a particular route, and that car's speed is also known because of the GPS signals. We know that this car is traveling at 45 miles per hour, and this car is moving from point A to point B. And on the way from point A to point B, at a particular point, there is a digital billboard. Just when the car is about to pass, we will change the digital billboard to the advertisement for New Balance shoes. balance shoe advertisement. Now, there's a good chance that the person may miss it because we have to, as an advertiser, we have to bombard from all directions, ensure that wherever you look, shoes, 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 shoes. Ultimately, we then decide to give that particular person, we have already been observing, right? We've observed that this particular person. Now, I am a person who uses my phone. Whenever, after the session, the first thing I'll probably do is updates on my WhatsApp, and after that, updates on my LinkedIn. All right, somebody may probably open Facebook, somebody may open Twitter, somebody may open anything else. All right, so this particular person is a person who's fond of Twitter, and she opens the Twitter account to see for any updates, etc. And there you go, you have a sponsored tweet from New Balance Shoes, 30% discount. I think this clinches the deal. So now, from right there, right now get 30% off. So click on that link, go to Amazon, make the payment, and you have the shoe delivered. Now, let us go back and look at what has happened. All right. Everything started with this particular click here. All right. And after that, the Uber company made some amount of money for taking the advertisement. The digital billboard company made some money out of, because they probably will be making some money because it will be only for a few seconds. Okay, it will come and it will go. So they made some money out of it. Twitter is going to charge for paid campaigns. Twitter made money out of it. Amazon makes money out of it. And obviously the New Balance is paying for all. We buying New Balance got the visibility or got a sale, which probably would not have happened unless somebody explicitly went to Amazon or somebody explicitly went to the store. So we have created multiple avenues of visibility so that the people are all right. Interesting, French. Anything you would like to comment at this point of time? All right. So yeah, we've lost some time, so let me try to make up for it. So another few minutes, I'll try to wrap it up. Yeah. So let me. What I'll do is now I'll quickly. Because data science fundamentals, what we were discussing about. So let me just explain about the analytics part of it. All right, this is the essential part. So at least you can carry back some takeaway today. So explain this to you using a simple explanation about something that everybody will like, a detective series. Okay. I'm sure all of you are reasonable fans of detective episodes, etc. So just explain this with you with a detective thing. So descriptive, diagnostic, predictive, and prescriptive analytics. These are the four stages of analytics that is part of your study of analytics. So imagine there is a crime scene, all right? There is a crime scene wherein when the detective comes, I'm talking about an American series, so when the detective comes in, he pulls up the yellow tape which says, crime scene, do not enter. He enters it. The policeman explains to him, all right? Policeman is reading from his notes, he's reading something. And you know that in about a few seconds after the policeman has finished reading whatever he is appraising the detective, when he opens the door into the house, the exact same thing will be able to see. So descriptive analytics is simply describing the thing as it is, all right, which is, something like, I'm a little bit of a skeptic for people who are no roadside who will say, no, I'll read your face, I'll read your palm readers, or the parrot astrologers, etc. Astrology per se, the entire panchang, etc. is a different thing. But those street side people, you know, who try to, you know, look at you and say, you know, I have got a prediction for you, try to, you know, take some money out of you, I have a little hesitation for them. So generally, those people will, I don't know if you've noticed this, but if they'll probably, you know, speak for about, if you let them speak for 10 minutes, 5 minutes or 8 minutes, they'll speak about things that you already know. They'll say things like, you know, you are a very disturbed man. Now, who isn't disturbed in these times? All right. And they will say about that you are, there is one thing that is you are earning for. Obviously, everybody is earning for that better job, better life, better thing, something better, one thing you can. So you are, whatever the person is saying, you are receiving it in such a way that that is what is seeming to be right. So descriptive is something similar. You're simply describing as things as they are. Now the detective is the one who diagnoses the situation, says, you know what, this crime scene probably has happened. He looks around and diagnoses and says why it has happened. Look at that wall, there seems to be a painting that is missing and somebody has stolen that particular painting. That is what it looks like. Oh great, so that is the diagnosis. Now the predictive analysis would be what is likely to happen. Now this painting, which is probably this big, all right, which is a pretty big painting which was hanging, which is a very expensive painting, is something that they cannot under any circumstance simply put it. So this is going to be sold very soon, somewhere or other, in the underground circles or in the private circles, somebody or other is going to give a call stating that, you know, these things are predictive analytic, these things are for this particular painting is for sale. And what is the prescriptive analytics? What is to be done? You try to find out where the sale is going to happen. Obviously, such a big painting cannot be transported without, you know, losing sight of it. And therefore, you try to prevent it, the sale, or try to, you know, join as a prospective buyer and do it. So this is a simple example, the stages of analytics, where we start from the very fundamental, where people will do the descriptive analytics. And then finally, you have something what is called as the prescriptive analytics. And in the departments also, the initial level is, you know, you have hundreds of thousands of records, lines of data. Go through that and try to bring out insights. Put out a graph, put this. Now, what is the insight that you have done? I feel that this particular, there is a huge correlation between column A with column B. I find that when people, in the summers, people are buying more products. These are some of the analysis that as I increase the number of my revenue, okay, I want you to please increase the revenue of my organization, and you end up doing a business model to say that by this way more people will come to your restaurant. I know how to get more people to come to the restaurant. I told you to increase my profits. People are coming to my restaurant and having coffee and going. All right, they're all ordering coffee and simply leaving. Nobody is simply coming and sitting in the air conditioned room, having coffee and leaving. What can I do to increase the profits and revenue? Footfalls is already high. I'm sorry sir, I thought you wanted footfalls. I was very clear. So the evaluation has to be in line with what your business problem is. That is one thing. And then of course deploying it into the system and checking whether or not we are getting the required results. If it is expectation of 20% revenue improvement in 20% revenue, is it 20% or it is only 5%? What should be done? So this process continues. So that very briefly was something I thought I'll just share with you. Now, because of the lack of time, I would wrap it up. But before I go, I would also like to invite you to, you know, I'm just sharing this link to you because you may want to learn more. Alright, so if you want to learn more, there are so many things available. I'm sharing this link. So I would invite you to, you know, subscribe to our YouTube channel. I have shared the link in the thing. So we have a whole lot of videos, and data science is for everybody. It's interesting that this particular video is at the top. This fellow is 14 years of age. He's in 9th standard. Okay. And he has taken up data science and AI both. And this is a small clip that he has given, telling about how his success was with us. So this is anybody and anybody can do that. And we have a whole list of programs that is available at 360 Digit MG. And we have our colleague will be very soon sharing a feedback link, all right, to you people about the course, etc. And if you want to know more about it, these are some of the things that you can choose from. Now, most of you are, I'm told this is an IT department, so yeah, data science makes sense, but you can also probably, you know, look into MLOps, which is the new thing that we are offering, using Kubeflow, all right, that is one thing. Cloud computing is another thing, AWS solution architect, this is something. IoT, obviously, is a little bit of, very, very little bit gone high. And cybersecurity is something that is a really big thing.
Okay.
And for anything, so I would now prefer to, you know, have some questions, because I'll spend another 10 minutes. But that will depend on what is the expectation of this particular person, any specific thing that you want to, you know about. And if I know the answer, I can explain to everything. If I know the answer, I'll definitely like to address it. So yeah, you're free to text me, unmute and speak, whatever. And then I'll be more than happy to try it. I've been learning data science for the last 5 years. Right? When I finished my data science course 5 years back, I thought I had learned data science. When I moved into data science, I now realize I have so much to learn. So it's been 5 years, I'm still learning data science. Data analytics, artificial intelligence, all these things I continue to learn. Whatever I've learned, I can help. Yeah, please.
17
bucks. 17.
Yes, please. Tarun. Yeah, Tarun.
Yeah. Sir, if someone's gonna work as a software engineer or software developer for the next 2 to 3 years, and then later on proceed with data science, what are the tools or things that he needs to grasp or have a plausible grip with himself in order to do data science later on in his career?
Sir? Okay, so point number one, if you are going to be a software developer, you're going to be working on a particular programming language. I think almost everybody is working predominantly in Java and Python, so both of them are good. Python is one thing that you need to do. Second, I would recommend, don't, if you're waiting to move into the data science career after 2 years, use 2 years to hone up your skills on fundamentals of statistics. All right, there are a lot of statistical concepts that are there. Keep refreshing them. Simple things like probability, probability distribution, etc. And go back to school. All right, go back to school and brush up on your differential calculus. That is my tip. So these three things: Python, statistics, little bit of differential. I would say probably about 15 to 20% would be differential calculus. The remaining two things about equally, if you can concentrate. So at the end of it, when you want to move into analytics field, you'll be able to take it to like fish like water. Yeah, my colleague has shared the Google form. There are two forms anyway. So you can just, I would really appreciate if all of you could, you know, fill it up or take some time out to fill it up. And I'm assuming that all of you have subscribed to our channel. Yeah, anybody else? Tarun, have I answered your question?
Yes, sir. And one more question, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, in case of analytics, should someone do any certification like IBM Data Analytics Certification or Google Data Analytics Certification, or it's like total waste of time doing certification instead of...
I wouldn't say it is a total waste of time. See, it is all about competitive, it's multiple things are being looked at. You put your resume for a company. So there's one resume. You and let us say Tarun and then another classmate XYZ, both of you put exactly same marks in all the subjects in all the 4 years. Assume, all right. But Tarun has gone ahead and done. In his school was a maths Olympiad. He was an athlete. He was a photographer. Forget maths Olympiad. He's an athlete. He's a photographer. He's in the debatics club. He's a cyclist. He's NSS. Tarun does all that. XYZ does nothing. Both of you score exactly the same. Who will get the job? Now,
obviously.
You get the point. All those skill sets have nothing to do with your job. But when it comes for a comparison, they're going to look at them. So I cannot say it is utterly waste. Don't do all these certifications. These certifications, when we have, see, we have got 10,000 applications. Somebody who comes up to me and says, you know, recently I interviewed a person. So what is your first thing that, you know, impressed me was, I'm a solo traveler. He he's an M-Tech. I'm a solo traveler. So how do you travel solo? You're doing your M-Tech. Luckily, my attendance is not so stringent. So 15, 20 days in a month, in every 3 months or so, I simply disappear. Sometimes without cell service, I travel all around the world. 10 minutes to interview the fellow. 10 minutes I have wasted in interviewing him, asking him about his solo trip, because that is something interesting. Nothing to do with the job I'm going to be given. Now I'm left with 20 minutes. I have to quickly ask him some questions and you see the situation.
In case of working professionals, sir.
Yeah.
Should they do certifications related to analytics, or could they do certification related to deployment or something like that, which will help really data science, will help them grasp more data science concepts like deployment, cloud deployment, or something like that?
Again, when you talk about experience, there's a lot of ambiguity in your question. I think there's another person who's raised their hand. I'll come to you after this question.
Yeah,
please. So when you come to the experience, see, experience can be 0 to 3, 3 to 5, 5 to 7, 7 to 10, 7 to 12, more than 12. Various bands are there. So a 0 to 3, even 0 to 5, the kind of skills that the expectation from people is that you are core. When I say core, you can go hands-on with programming, you can go hands-on with cloud deployment, you can go hands-on with MLOps, you can go hands-on with, you know, integration and pipeline development, and all those kind of things are the expectation. Now I, with X number of years of experience, if I have to apply for a job, if somebody says, you know, okay, this is a small snippet of code, can you please execute it? I'll get up and walk out. Alright, if somebody in the interview panel invites me and gives me a small code and say, you know, please can you complete this code, I'll simply get up and walk out. I said, I think I'm in the wrong room. What is it that I can bring as a leader to the table? So again, the certification depends on which position you are in. Alright, so that is essentially the thing that you need to remember, alright, when you are looking at certification. And absolutely right. Now, for instance, if I have to do a certification at whatever age I am, I'll be doing more of management kind of a certification. I'm an alumnus of IIM Lucknow. Alright. Alumnus of IIM Lucknow in the data science program. So that particular certification is more so in the management perspective rather than the core programming perspective. There is a program offered by, there are various colleges offering 4 2-year M-Tech programs. That is hardcore. Right? I wouldn't join that. You get the point? Yeah?
Yes, so sir. Sir, what about this Great Lakes advertising their data science courses?
I'm not able to comment about my competitor, as simple as that, because I am 360-digit MG. I would only talk about 360-digit MG. But I always invite the participants to do their due diligence, all right? And, you know, never ever believe on one person. Don't believe me. Go to the market, do the study, do the due diligence, everything, and then take a call on that. So you mentioned one person, I can mention three more people, but please talk to all of them. And there are various factors that you take into a decision. Do you have 3 lakh rupees, or do you have only 30,000 rupees? Do you have 2 years time, or do you have only 6 months time? Right? What is your expectation? What is the track record? So many things would be there. Tarun, I'm sorry, but I would now request Sri Sudha to, you know, have put a question. Yeah, the message is there, Annanagar, 360-digit MG Porur, and the mobile number has been provided there. So you can, Tarun and the other friends, you can, anybody, you can probably join them. Yes, Sai Sudha.
Good afternoon, sir. So I just have two questions. One is, for an aspiring data scientist or a data analytic person, which language is more preferable, sir, Python or R?
So you want me to answer right away? It is Python.
Python. Okay, sir. But as far as...
Having said that, don't divorce R. All right?
Yes.
If you get married to Python, but don't divorce R. Keep R also on the side, because there are certain things, albeit very small, but there are certain things about R that is good. So primary focus should be probably about 70 to 80% you might want to, you know, focus on Python, and about 20 to 30% on R. Is that way I take it. Next question.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. And one more question is, you were telling about learning differential calculus, but like I understand what is, like we need to understand the purpose of gradient descent and all, but we also have this sklearn library in Python, and it already does all the jobs when we call the APIs. So how well we need to know the statistics and differential calculus when it comes to?
Okay, so the differentiating factor of a data scientist from another data scientist is, I go to my boss and say, sir, I run a model and this is the output. Now if my boss asks me, okay, but why is it like this? I don't know, sir, model said so, must be correct. What is my boss going to feel? This fellow knows nothing, he only knows programming and he's able to do that. Now, as a data scientist, as having some grip on some statistical analysis, some of the things from the back end things, I feel what probably has happened is my data is behaving in a certain way. It is probably not perfectly. So that is why my model is recommending this. So therefore, I probably can go and, you know, transform my data into something else, because I also know the theory behind the output. I'm able to give better insights. Ultimately, it is my model, it is Python, it is MATLAB, it is so many things that is going to give. I'm not going to be doing with a calculator and, you know, work on the thing and give the answer. Nobody does that. Nobody draws the, you know, dy by dou y by dou x. Nobody does that. Why I'm saying that you need to know that is, you are able to interpret the results that is being obtained and also try to know where, what button should I press to improve upon it. Nobody expects you to actually sit down and do statistical formulas, statistical things like that. That is the reason why I mentioned. Does it answer your question?
Yes, sir. But the one more question is, we can also, if we are training our model in, say, let's say linear model, and I'm doing a regression analysis, and I can also use this k-folding, and I can check with other models now, sir. And
absolutely.
So my model is, if I'm checking with other models, I'll
in
get
spite
which
of,
one is more accurate.
Yeah, it's spiky. You have been used to some textbook models, etc. You have done that. In spite of all the models trained, you get 56% accuracy. You have tried K-fold, you have tried various tuning parameters, you have tried regularization, everything, decision tree, everything you have tried, and still you are getting 57, 58, 59% maximum you are getting. So, whom will you blame?
Data,
we can't
blame the library, but
data.
We'll have
blame the data,
to make
right?
our own machine learning model.
No, you'll blame the data, right? Data is
yes.
inadequate. Probably you'll blame the data. Now, okay, you blame the data. So, can the data become all right? Now, what as a data scientist you will do? Now, put all the machine learning libraries apart. Put all the code, put Python, everything apart. Put everything aside. Now, you and the data are sitting. What can you as a data scientist do with the data? That is where all these learning, am I communicating?
Yes,
sir. If you are just a glorified stenographer, sir, a glorified typist. Typist, sir, meaning enna sonninga adha type panna. Sorry, I'm using vernacular because very rarely I get a chance to speak in Tamil in Hyderabad. Meaning enna sonninga na type panna. You did not understand that I'm writing a letter written here, sir, and I'm saying somewhere I'm feeling that. You don't know, sir. You said, dear sir, there I go. The reason why it is always important, because whatever you are talking about, say for everything you are talking about, 5 years,
yes.
Auto-ML, even that you don't have to do, input here, output there. What is this output? Only a data scientist will do. You get the point?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Yeah. I hope you've made note of this number here, 9884092863. That is our Annanagar Center, Learning Center there. And I hope all of you have given your feedbacks. So if there are no questions, then we can wrap it up.
Excuse me, sir. Actually, I had one doubt, sir.
Yeah.
Actually, I have learned some automated ML machine learning using AWS,
okay.
Past sentiment analysis. Actually, in that, the automatic biasing has been done and validation, and also the hyperparameters were tuned. Is
okay.
it possible to do the same type of automated ML in any other data type? Actually, sentiment what? Analysis is done in textual
data.
Yes, yes.
So what model? Okay, AutoML. So at least what model was used in the backend, or it was an ensemble model?
What you are asking, sir?
No, in that AutoML also, what algorithm was used in the backend? Is that known, or is it just
it is not
black box?
No, it is not known, sir.
It is a black box
yes,
kind of a
yes,
thing.
Yes.
Okay. See, AutoML. See, working with the textual data. It is easy. So if anything is possible in unstructured data, by that logic, it should be very easily possible in structured data as well, is what I say. But I'll have to probably get into the specifics of it. What is the outcome that you have got? Let us say if it is a predictive model.
It tells that whether any commands, that is, we got a negative command or positive command or neutral command. That is
okay.
A prediction.
So this is basically a three-class classification problem.
Yes, yes. Classification.
A three-class classification problem. And the inputs is textual data. So you have, if you put it into structured data, it is probably probably few hundred columns of the. So on similar lines, if I have three class output and any number of inputs, yes, definitely AutoML will work. It will. You can probably put a decision tree also, right, or any ensemble techniques, bagging, boosting, all these things will perfectly
yes.
work for that also.
Okay.
It will work.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Nitin, for the wonderful session. Thank you, Rani ma'am, and the chairperson of SRM Ramapuram campus for giving us 360 digit MG an opportunity again and again. We are so glad that we are associating with you. This is a humble request to all the participants to kindly fill in the feedback form. And also, for any of your training, learning needs, you can reach us out to Porur or Ananaga branch. The number is being sent in the chat message. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much again. Thank you, Mr. Nitin.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. On behalf of the Department of Information Technology, I would like to thank our esteemed guest speaker of the day, Dr. Nitin Mishra, for his wonderful and enlightening session on the Introduction to Data Science. I'm sure that our students could be benefited by the session, as they could have gained a lot of insight towards the data science, which is the recent trend of the IT department. Thanks a lot, sir. I thank our dean, engineering technology, and the management for supporting us in the smooth conduct of the guest lecture. I also thank our HOD, Dr. B. Dora,
sir, senior faculty, Ms. Astronomy ma'am, and all the teaching and non-teaching faculty members of Department of IT.
Thanks to all our students for the participation and active interaction, and I would like to thank Dr. Nitin Mishra sir for his valuable time in his busy schedule. Thank you, Anand. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, sure, I'll stop the recording.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, I cannot leave till everybody leaves because this is my link. So I would wait for everybody to leave. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Otherwise, it will keep running, no? So I'll not know.
Yeah, sure. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.